Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. Have mercy on us, O Lord, for we have sinned against you. Show us, O Lord, your mercy and grant us your salvation. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Amen. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. May your grace, O Lord, we pray, at all times go before us and follow after and make us always determined to carry out good works through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for our people a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines stained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over our people, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from our faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, Lord, this is our God. We have waited for him, so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. For the hand of the Lord will rest on this mountain. The word of the Lord. Response to responsorial psalm. I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He destroys my soul. I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life. He leads me in the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. Second reading is a reading from the letter of St. Paul to Philippians. Brothers and sisters, I know what it is to have little, and I know what it is to have plenty. In any and all circumstances, I have learned the secret of being well fed and of going hungry, of having plenty and of being in need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. In any case, it was kind of you to share my distress. My God will fully satisfy every need of yours, according to his riches and the glory of Christ Jesus. To our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord. May the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ enlighten the eyes of our hearts, that we might know the hope to which we are called.
Once more, Jesus spoke to the chief priests and Pharisees in parables. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his slaves to call those who had been invited to the wedding banquet, but they would not come. Again, he sent other slaves, saying, "Tell those who have been invited, 'Look, I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they made light of it and went away, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his slaves, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. Then he said to his slaves, 'The wedding is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go therefore into the main streets and invite everyone you find to the wedding banquet.' Those slaves went out into the streets and gathered all whom they found, both good and bad. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing a wedding robe. And he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding robe?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, 'Bind him hand and foot and throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen.'" The Gospel of the Lord. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Happy Thanksgiving to you all. It's lovely to see the children here this morning. The readings this morning are challenging, but I think there's a theme that goes through them, and the theme is gratitude. Paul tells us that he knows what it is to be hungry, to have enough food. In another place, in one of his letters, he tells us how many times he's been beaten, put in jail, shipwrecked, and all of it is nothing compared to how much he loves Christ, how thankful he is to Christ. So gratitude and thanksgiving are central to the readings this morning. Gratitude is the basis of all prayer. We can only supplicate somebody we know is going to help us because of a relationship we have. So in gratitude, we can ask for something. In gratitude for the relationship. In gratitude for the loving kindness that God shows us. In gratitude for all the gifts he's given us. And the greatest of all of these gifts, as the Catechism tells us, is the Eucharist, the source and summit of our faith. In the first reading from Isaiah, it talks about this wonderful feast that the king is going to give to us. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. The Eucharist is the sign of the Lamb's Supper that we will share with him on the last day. It brings the kingdom of God to earth. We share in this supper now. It's a wonderful thing. Participation in the Eucharist heals our souls. But there's an invitation there. There's an invitation for all of us to participate with a good disposition in the Eucharist. in the sacrifice of the Mass. Our first invitation kind of reminds us of the invitation in the Gospel. Our first invitation is through baptism, when we receive sanctifying grace, faith, hope, and charity. So our responsibility as parents to try and develop that faith, hope, and charity in our children so that they can respond more fully to their original invitation at baptism. And at confirmation, we reaffirm our commitment to our solidarity with our faith, with Christ. And then we receive a fullness of the Spirit. A fullness of the Spirit. We receive 7 gifts of the Holy Spirit. And now we are called in a deeper way to develop these spirits, or these gifts. Each one of us is called individually. Each one of us have a specific charism, something that makes us different than everybody else. These are our gifts given to us by the Holy Spirit. How do we develop them? How do we develop them? Part of our development of our gifts is centered on gratitude. The Bible starts with this wonderful story how God created man in his own image and likeness. So part of our attitude goes right back to the way we are created. As it says in the Gospel, the king invited the good and the bad. We've all been invited. But we're all created in his image. And we are called to choose to develop the likeness to God that we have been called to. And this comes through grace. It comes through grace. None of us can do it on our own. We can try and follow the commandments, and we fall. And we might get to the point where we don't commit any sins against the commandments, but then maybe we're not generous enough. Maybe we're not forgiving enough. Maybe we're not loving enough. Maybe we're not patient enough. Grace from God helps us to develop in these areas. The final part of the Gospel, there's a person there who isn't dressed ready for the banquet. This reminds us that we need to be ready for the banquet. If I was going to see the Queen, I would have to, I wouldn't have to cut my hair, but I'd have to wash, I'd have to shave, I'd have to put on clean clothes. It's the same when we've been called to the banquet. What are the clean clothes I need to put on today as I receive Holy Communion? And if I'm not in that state of grace, what do I need to do? Confession is a central sacrament for us as Catholics. It draws us into this beautiful, deeper relationship with Christ. And it allows us to be grateful in a deeper way, because we go in with our dirty clothes on, and we come out sparkling like a child. How beautiful is that? Ready to start again, but knowing that life is difficult, that we cannot do it on our own. The Catechism of the Catholic Church tells us life is difficult, We cannot do it on our own. We need God's grace. That's wonderful. That's another thing to be grateful for. Sitting in church today, when so much of our society is closed, that is a reason to be grateful. How do we bring this gratitude out into the world? In a way that reminds people that they too have been called to the supper of the Lamb. How can I live a life of gratitude so that I make God's grace available through the way I treat others? It's a huge question, and it demands thought, and it demands repentance, and it demands gratitude to a God who forgives and forgives and forgives, as long as we're moving forward to Him. So this week, let us reflect on how we respond to the invitation that God gives us through the sacraments of the Catholic Church. Or our lack of gratitude for the sacraments that were instituted in the Catholic Church. And maybe if we are falling short in one of those areas, we can take a new first step. Go to confession. Be open to grace. Amen. And now Tony will say our prayers of the faithful. You've carried our intentions.
The answer to the prayers, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the church and community committed to faith and justice, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the leaders of nations, called to effective action on behalf of the poor, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For people uprooted by war or natural disaster, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For this community, called as a parish to act justly and lovingly, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our neighbors to the south as they prepare for their elections, that they are given grace and understanding, Lord,
hear our prayer.
As countries are militarizing, are having war games, are developing strategies for war domination, that peace may reign in our hearts so that we can bring peace to the world, Lord. And for an increase in vocations, to all vocations, to the vocation of marriage, to a deeper commitment to our vocation as members of the church, and for good shepherds in the church, Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Accept, O Lord, the prayers of your faithful with the sacrificial offerings, that through these acts of devotedness we may pass over to the glory of heaven, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
At our Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let's serve each other, sign of Christ's peace. Suffer want and go hungry, but those who seek the Lord lack no blessing.
Good morning, everyone. Please take a copy of the bulletin. much better. He will be back with us next weekend. He's anxious to get back. So, thank goodness, our prayers are answered. He's feeling well. Just to remind you that thank you for those who signed our petition. Oh, sorry. Thank you for those who signed our petition. It's for that reason the bishops were able to meet with the government, and that's why if you're in the green, yellow, or orange level, this church could be full, and the reason that we're allowed 25 people in the red zone. So thank you very much. That really helped, and we're happy for that. Please, if you're thinking of coming next weekend, please sign up, because unfortunately I have to turn people away this morning because they didn't sign up. So this kills me. It kills Deacon Nick too, that you know we can only have 25 people and we have to turn people away. But if we're caught having more, well, it's even worse. So the reason we are sticking to it is that if somehow an inspector came in, then they could close not just us, but they could close everybody in our diocese. So we have to be in solidarity with each other. I'd like to thank Deacon Nick for his last 3 weeks of service. Without him, we wouldn't have had anything. Have a good week, and see you next week.
We entreat your majesty most humbly, O Lord, that as you feed us with the nourishment which comes from the most holy body and blood of your Son, so you may make us sharers of his divine nature, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
And maybe before we go, we can say Hail Mary for an increase in vocations.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Pray to Saint Michael. Saint Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our safeguard against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly hosts, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world, seeking the ruin of souls. Amen.
Amen.
Happy Thanksgiving, everyone.